pains and penalties of perjury.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. With that, please be seated. Please state your name and spell it for the record.
Ronald Page, R-O-N-A-L-D-P-A-G-E.
And what do you do for a living?
Police officer in the town of Pelham.
How long have you been a police officer with the town of Pelham?
Just over 16 years.
16 years. What is your current rank, sir?
Sergeant.
Sergeant? How long have you been a sergeant with the Pelham Police?
Three and a half years, coming up on four.
So can you tell the jury, can you give the jury an understanding about your training and experience as a police officer?
Yes, I graduated 144 Academy in November of 2007. I've been brought up as an instructor within the agency in various fields, from use of force through medical stuff, FTO, and various other aspects within the patrol division.
And before, I think you said you joined in 2007?
Yes.
Before 2007, what training and experience did you have?
I was in the Marine Corps.
How long were you in the Marine Corps?
Enlisted in 2003, went to boot camp 2003 as a reservist, and got out in 2010 as a reservist.
Can you tell us where you actually served?
Yes, I served two combat tours in Iraq, one in 2004 through 2005, another one 2009 through 2010.
What did you do in the Marines?
A lot of different things. My primary MOS was military policeman at the time.
Did you have any specific training with respect to providing medical care?
Yes, part of the Marine Corps back then, so obviously the war was going on. We had a lot of medical training within, we call it Buddy 8 or TCCC, Tactical Combat Casualty Care. It's basically the field EMT type of deal where it's, you know, bandages, tourniquets, occlusive dressing, stuff like that.
And in your experience working in the Marines, what type of wounds would you encounter?
Gunshot wounds, blast wounds, crushing wounds, burn wounds, stuff of that nature.
And with respect, let's move forward now to your experience with the Pelham Police Department. What is your role within the Pelham Police Department?
As a patrolman, or as a patrol sergeant, I should say?
Yes.
My job as patrol sergeant is overseeing the day shift. I'm in charge of the day shift, so I see day shift operations. Make sure the duties are done throughout the day correctly.
Do you have any other duties with respect to law enforcement?
Yes, I'm also a tactical team leader for Southern New Hampshire Special Operations Unit, SWAT team.
Okay. How long have you been doing that?
10 years.
And what does that consist of?
We handle calls of service that patrol cannot normally handle. Barricaded subjects, hostage situations, recovery, rescue, and stuff of that nature. A little beyond what patrol can handle.
And what skills do you bring to that team?
In the younger ranks, I was a tactical medic on the team, where I was assigned as a basic operator within the team, but I would also assist the team paramedics with medical aid if needed.
Thank you, Sergeant. So, with respect to this matter, let me bring your attention to October 12th of 2019. Were you on duty at around 10:12 a.m. on October 12, 2019?
Yes, sir.
And at that time, at around 10:12, were you dispatched to any particular area?
Yes, sir.
Where were you dispatched to?
955 Bridge Street, New England Pentecostal Church.
I'm sorry, you said New England Pentecostal Church?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And when you arrived, how did you arrive?
By my cruiser.
And when you arrived in the cruiser, where did you go?
I parked directly to the right-hand side of the front door.
And once you got to the parking lot there at the New England Pentecostal, what steps did you take next?
From that point, exited my cruiser, slung my rifle, and made entry into the building.
Okay. Why did you have your rifle?
Because a call came in as an armed individual.
So when you... did you then enter the church at this point?
Yes, I did.
Okay, when you entered the church at this point, what did you observe?
Observed approximately 50 individuals in a state of panic and shock, and the fire alarm was going off. A lot of chaos within the room.
Did you see any people who required medical care?
Not immediately.
Eventually, though, did you?
Yes, I did. Eventually, yes.
When you went into the church, Who did you see that required medical care?
Mr. Choate.
When you say Mr. Choate, where was Mr. Choate?
By the podium, on the podium, by the altar.
Okay. And can you describe his position when you saw?
Yes, he was on his back.
And what observations did you make when you saw Mr. Choate?
So Mr. Choate was clearly injured due to the amount of blood on his shirt, arms, and hands.
Did you provide Mr. Choate with any sort of medical treatment at this point?
Very basic at that point, yes.
So you
very, very basic, yes.
Okay. What did this basic treatment
come from? Between me putting on my gloves, giving him verbal reassurance that it's going to be all right, I cut his shirt away from him, exposing a wound to his upper chest throat area.
Okay. Can you describe what this wound looked like?
It was consistent with a gunshot wound.
And when you say consistent with a gunshot wound, what exactly do you mean?
A round hole in the chest area.
And what steps did you take at this point, Sergeant?
At that point, I went through my what we consider a bath assessment, started searching for additional wounds and injuries that would take priority over that, such as major bleeding. So I conducted an assessment on him. I saw no further wounds that needed to be addressed or prioritized over that single wound at that point.
So what happened next with respect to Mr. Choate?
At that point, I continued to talk to him, and the Pelham Fire Department EMTs arrived on scene.
And what did they do?
At that point, I relinquished Mr. Choate over to them as higher point of care.
Okay, so at this point, after you relinquished care of Mr. Choate to the EMTs, what steps did you then take?
I went looking for additional injuries.
And did you encounter anyone?
I did.
Who had additional injuries?
Yes, I did.
Okay. And where was this person?
She was in the pew section. I believe it was the center section of the pews.
And when you saw this person, can you tell us a little bit about how she appeared?
Yes. When I got up to her, I observed that she had what we would call a through-and-through gunshot wound to her right arm above her right elbow.
And what did you note about this injury?
What
did you note about the injury itself?
That it was consistent with a gunshot wound, and that was bleeding.
So, did you make any decisions relative to care for this this person?
Yes, I did. At that point, I was able to take a tourniquet from Chief Perriello, Lieutenant Perriello at the time, and I applied the tourniquet to her upper right arm.
Okay. When you say a tourniquet, what do you mean?
Tourniquet is a device used to stop the bleeding by applying direct pressure. By applying pressure to an artery, it closes off that artery to stop the bleeding from going beyond that point.
Okay, so can you describe what this tourniquet looked like?
Yes, it's a. They do come in different colors. However, the ones we carry are black. It's a nylon material with what we call a windlass on it. It's a device you spin on it to close down on the device.
And what are the dimensions of this tourniquet?
Fully open or on average? It can be various sizes.
Well, when you use this?
Just at the point slightly bigger than the extremity you're putting it on, and then from there you Velcro it down even further and close the windlass.
So how many inches are we talking about here in terms of how this tourniquet, if you recall?
The device itself is about 2 inches wide.
And so what did you do with this tourniquet?
I applied it to Claire.
And what did you note about Claire's arms at this point?
Claire is a very skinny lady where I had a difficult time actually putting the tourniquet correctly on her. However, I did adequately use it and slowed the bleeding down.
You mentioned the name Claire. How did you know this woman's name was Claire?
I asked her name.
And that's what she said?
Yes. Yes, sir.
And so, did you provide any other treatment to Claire?
Once the tourniquet was on her and I assessed that the bleeding had slowed down, not completely stopped, another Pelham Fire EMT came up to my side and I relinquished her care over to him.
Eventually, did you speak with any other potential witnesses in this case as a part of your presence and investigation at the New England Pelham Hospital?
After relinquishing Claire over to the EMT, I scanned the room looking for additional individuals with injuries at that point.
Eventually, did you happen to speak with a Mr. Archer?
Mr. Archer?
Yes.
At some point, yes.
Okay. And after speaking with Mr. Archer, did you and other officers have an opportunity to look at any sort of surveillance footage from the tree?
We did, yes.
And what, if you recall, can you tell us a little bit about this footage that you observed?
The initial footage that I saw was surveillance footage from the outside of the building, facing the main entrance and the exit to the parking lot. And
this footage, was it in color or was it in black and white?
That particular footage was black and white.
And after you rendered aid to both Mr. Church and Claire, what did you observe about the condition of your body at this point?
I was covered in blood.
So at this point, Sergeant, I'm going to ask the bailiff to bring you State's Exhibit 18.
Exhibit 18. Just give Liz a minute to find that. Get it to Bob. Open there.
Judge, we're going to ask the bailiff bring gloves up to
sure.
The witness.
Yes, sir.
I'd ask you to open up this bag.
How the bag is sealed.
Right. Now would be the time to unseal it.
Okay.
So I'm going to ask
you. Just move it away.
Thank you. Sorry.
This is heavy about this.
Sorry about that.
That's okay.
So, Sergeant, I'm going to ask you to look into the bag and see if you can find the tourniquet about which you mentioned earlier.
Yes, there is a tourniquet in there.
Do you see the tourniquet in there?
Yes, sir.
Can you actually bring it out of the bag? Okay. Does this look like the tourniquet that you used to apply to Claire's arm back on October 12th?
Yes, sir.
Does it pretty much have the same dimensions that what you described earlier?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I have nothing further. If you could put that back into the bag. Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you, Attorney Hardy. I'll turn it to you, Mr. Holloway, for cross-examination.
Good morning, Sergeant. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. At that time, yes, sir.
At that time, does it now?
Yes, sir.
So it was recording that whole time?
Yes.
When you observed the injuries of these victims, did you assess them in your mind as serious or non-life-threatening injuries?
Based off what I observed, I prioritize based off an assessment that we go through, starting with major bleeding, and then going down the list of what we can fix at that time. Due to the location of Mr. Cho's injuries, I determined that to be a significant injury, yes.
Okay. Did you think he was going to die?
I do not know.
Did you tell him he was going to die?
Did I tell him that he was going to die?
Yes.
I did not.
Okay. Did you tell him he was not going to die?
I don't know. Do not remember.
You don't recall?
No.
So if I played your video, your cruiser video, sorry, excuse me. Let me ask you another question before I get to that. You went away from your cruiser into the church, correct?
Yes, sir.
And your audio could still be heard from your cruiser, correct?
Yes, we had an audio device on my shoulder, my lapel.
Sorry, I wanted to establish that before I asked the next question. So my next question would be, if I played that video for you, would you remember what you said then?
If I heard the video, yes.
Okay. Your Honor, I have the video here, but I'm pretty sure the state has the cruiser video. I don't really know how to...
Okay, let me check with him. Okay. You want to refresh his memory?
Yes. So I want to refresh your memory by using the video on whether you asked Mr. Choate. I mean, whether you told Mr. Choate that he was not going to die.
Right. And if we're going to do that, we don't object. But if we're going to do that, I think it's going to be outside the presence of the jury.
It does. Right. Yes, absolutely. So do you have that, and you're able to do that for him? Can we find that quickly?
I don't know if we have this queued up right now.
Oh, I know you don't have it queued up now. Right. I just mean, do you have it so we can queue it when I release the jury?
We have the binder of discs, Your Honor. We can try to assist Mr. Holloway in trying to play that for court.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to excuse you just for a minute while we do this. You don't need to sit here, and it's not something that you can hear because it's just meant to refresh memory at this point anyway. So we'll excuse you out of the deliberation room, and we'll get you when it is necessary.
All rise for the jury.